So I want to start by acknowledging the organizers for inviting me to give this talk in this workshop. So what I want to talk here, besides the title in this talk, is about the quantization of symmetry reduced models in loop quantum gravity, discuss questions about defective geometries, singularity resolution, and perhaps how to extract predictions out of these effective geometries. So I think many people would agree with me, as this is my opinion, that general relativity should be somehow replaced by some more fundamental theory close to the high curvature regimes because of the existence of these singularity theorems by Hawking and Penrose. But in general, any quantum theory of gravity, any candidate, should be able to answer several questions that I think are fundamental. The first one is, what is the nature of spacetime close to the high curvature regimes, if there is any? If these candidates would be able to resolve all singularities that we see in the classical theory, if not, at least which ones are going to be solved? Then what kind of observables we can access related with the high curvature regions, the quantum regions of these theories, especially if there is some windows for observation that we can explore today, either in cosmology or black hole physics. And finally, since usually these proposals are very complicated, at least we don't have a good control today, whether it is possible to build simpler models that will allow us to extract predictions that could be compared with observations, eventually even to rule out this model or even the full theories. So among the symmetry reduced models that I want to consider here, I will just focus on cosmological models, like for instance Freeman-Robertson worker or Bianchi spacetimes, and black hole solutions like sparsely or Kerr geometries are the ones that are more interesting. Actually, I will just focus on sparsely ones because Kerr is still not well understood at the moment in loop quantum gravity. That is the quantum theory I want to discuss or I'm going to talk about today. So within this theory, it is not obvious. I mean, if we want to do extract some prediction, we should be able to, given an initial state on the theory, do evolution. But at the moment, we don't know how to do that, right? So one possibility that has been proposed last year is extracting simpler models from the full theory. That is something that has been done by many people, for instance, the work by Emmanuel Aleschi or Andrea Dapour or Daniel Oriti in these lines. But here I'm going to focus on the quantization of symmetry reduced models. So our experience in this research area is that we can learn many interesting things from these models that can be applied into the full theory, not only physical ones, but also mathematical. And among them, we can find, for instance, or we can understand semi-classical sectors of the theory that are in agreement with general relativity, or even we can extract predictions that could be eventually compared with observations. So one of the models that have been studied in more detail in loop quantum cosmology is a flat Freeman-Robertson-Walker spacetime coupled to a massless scalar field. Here, if you choose the scalar field as a physical clock, it is possible to solve the dynamics, the quantum dynamics of the system. We know also that singularities are resolved in this model in a very precise sense. For instance, you can start with a semi-classical state that is peaked on a given classical geometry, evolve it back in time, and you will see that this state will not reach the singularity, but it will actually bounce. We can also identify semi-classical sectors and deduce out of them effective dynamics that provides very simple and clear equations that everybody can understand. For instance, the modified Freeman-Robertson-Walker equation that you can see here, where quantum gravity effects become important when the energy density becomes of the order of some critical energy density that is of the order of Planck energy density. So all these questions, all these aspects about the dynamics have been also studied or understood in several other models. For instance, Freeman-Robertson-Walker with positive curvature, when you add cosmological constant, positive or negative, when you consider some other kinds of matter content like universes dominated by radiation, and even in homogeneous anisotropic cosmological models like Bianchi one. So here I want to spend a little bit of time because this is something that is going to be relevant later. In this model, there is a particular model studied in this paper here where you can solve completely the quantum dynamics of the system. And in the right plot here, you can choose a clock, physical clock, that is essentially one of the connections of one of the scale factors of your model. This physical clock is a monotonous function, especially in this region where you see the quantum effects are important and you have several bounces of the different scale factors. But also it was proposed that instead of using a clock that is a monotonic function, you can choose one of the scale factors that is not monotonic. So in order to do something like this in the quantum theory, you should be able to split the evolution in the two branches in which the corresponding scale factor, that is the time that you are considering, is monotonic. And here you can see that this is what happens when you choose the time in the different branches where it is monotonic. In this concrete example, is one of the trials what is called A1 or V1, that is here in this axis, and you plot V2, the other scale factor, as a function of the first one. The only thing that happens is that, as one should expect, is that something funny is going to happen at the time when the corresponding clock bounces. So it's not, strictly speaking, quite monotonic function there. And just let me mention that there are some other spacetimes that have been considered, anisotropic spacetime, but only from the point of view of an effective description, like some other Bianchi models, and also Kantosky such geometries that are relevant for interior of black holes.
So in this, in those works, you use canonical, for example. Right?
Yes, a canonical.
Do you use some effective Hamiltonian?
No.
No.
You mean in these models in
yes.
In this Bianchi? Oh yeah, exactly. Yes, it's some effective Hamiltonian.
And,
yes.
And what about the self-adjointness of this Hamiltonian in the case of positive cosmological constant? The reason I'm asking is that in case of isotropic model, if cosmological constant is positive, then we need to choose self-adjoint extension.
Yeah, that is true. But
so
essentially, the physical results. For this Bianchi 1 spacetimes, well, in this particular model, no, it's not the same. You have one self-adjoint extension. Yes. So now, what happens when you go beyond the homogeneous models and you consider inhomogeneous spacetimes? For instance, in spherically symmetric spacetimes and polarized Gaudi models, that are the ones that I'm going to consider here, there was a proposal several years ago how to reduce the classical theory in Azteca Barbero variables, how you can build a robust kinematical Hilbert space that is well adapted to these symmetry reduced models, and also you can build a Hamiltonian constraint following the ideas of the full theory, loop quantum gravity. This quantum Hamiltonian constraint has a well-defined action on the kinematical Hilbert space, but on the other hand, we don't know very much about whether the constraint algebra at the quantum level is consistent, whether we can find the solutions. We don't know anything about the solutions in this description. So still, it's a quantization that is very nice, but this is still formal in some sense. Later on, there was some proposal in order to deal with the quantization of Gaudi cosmologies. And here, it was proposed to consider a partial gauge fixing for the theory and then combine a loop representation together with a fog quantization for the homogeneous and the inhomogeneous degrees of freedom, respectively. There you have two homogeneous constraints, one scalar constraint, one diffeomorphism constraint. You can provide the solutions, build the physical Hilbert space, but again, all the construction is formal because nobody, as far as I know, has been able to solve the quantum dynamics of this model. But one of the advantages that you have in this description, in this hybrid quantization, is that you can still analyze the effective dynamics of the model. Something that has been done, but just not in much detail. But in the last year, we were very lucky that Gambini and Pulin, they proposed a way to deal with the quantization of spherically symmetric spacetimes by adopting an abelian constraint. Essentially, you start with the classical theory, you have two constraints, the scalar and the diffeo, and then you build a new scalar constraint by suitably combining the original scalar constraint and the diffeo constraint. And the nice thing is that the new Hamiltonian constraint codifies essentially the same dynamics than the original one, with the advantage that the constraint commutes with itself, not only at the classical level, but also at the quantum level in this loop representation. Here, the kinematical Hilbert space is the same that was proposed originally in the previous works. The basic building blocks are spin networks that are nothing but just linear combinations of products of holonomies in the radial direction, that we interpret as edges of these one-dimensional graphs, and point holonomies in the transverse direction that we interpret as vertices. And the corresponding variances of these edges and vertices can be interpreted as the eigenvalues of the conjugate variables to the connection, the components of this connection, that are nothing but the fluxes of the triad. So you can see from the kinematical inner product that this normalization with respect to the Kronecker deltas is telling you that the geometry, quantum geometry, is going to be discrete. So now in this kinematical Hilbert space, we can define the Hamiltonian constraint. We can also identify the solutions to the constraints that are essentially those states that are invariant under the transformation generated by the Diffeo and the scalar constraint, identify a suitable inner product, and then together with the solutions and this inner product, build the physical Hilbert space. On this physical Hilbert space, we have well-defined Dirac observables. There is one that corresponds to the homogeneous or to the global degree of freedom that these theories have. For instance, in a spherically symmetric spacetime, the mass of the black holes, in the case of vacuum, of course, and in a situation of Gaudi cosmology with local rotational symmetry, that is the other model I'm going to consider here, is the essentially the degree of freedom corresponds to the densitized CR scalar. That's another Dirac observable in the classical theory. Just let me mention that these quantization techniques also can be applied to 1 plus 1 spacetimes, dilatonic black holes in vacuum, but I'm not going to give any details here today. So, together with these Dirac observables, in the quantum theory there is new Dirac observables, a new family of Dirac observables. They don't have a classical analog in the sense of another classical Dirac observable, but they have a classical interpretation, and they correspond essentially to the areas of the Killing orbits. For instance, in the case of the spherically symmetric spacetimes, it corresponds to the areas of the two spheres, and these areas are quantized, even by this k here that essentially takes is an integer. So now what can we do with this quantization? We can build effective geometries. In order to do so, one can adopt a description in terms of parametrized observables that basically one considers a classical gauge fixing, identifies what are the Dirac observables, what are parameters or coordinates, then you promote these classical quantities to operators, and then you can compute expectation values of these quantities. Here I am giving an example. For instance, when you consider the line element in the spatially flat gauge fixing and the corresponding effective geometry that you will get. So these geometries, the property they have is that they are discrete, they are piecewise constant, they are also regular in the high curvature regions, but we know very little about these effective geometries. For instance, we don't know at the moment how to compute the curvature of these geometries, if this curvature, the corresponding scalars, they are bounded above, if this bound is universal, whether we can extend these geometries beyond these high curvature regions, if they are stable. So there are many questions that we don't understand. Or, for instance, something that I believe is very interesting, what is the interplay between this the horizon of these geometries and the discrete geometry when both of them are fluctuating. So all these techniques, we saw that in the case of black holes, they can also be applied for this Gaudi cosmology with local rotational symmetry. And here these cosmologies are very interesting physically because they are diffeomorphic to Bianchi 1 spacetimes with axial symmetry or local rotational symmetry. And they were studied in the context of inflation by Sonia Pavan and collaborators several years ago. So again, you can get discrete geometries that are regular with these very nice properties. But we also propose, because we were not completely satisfied with the description using parametrized observables, I will just mention something at the end if I have some time. And then we decided to propose, instead of using this parametrized observable, introduce some sense or a notion of Hamiltonian evolution in the quantum theory. So in order to do so, just let me mention that we adopted a description in terms of an improved dynamics scheme. This is something a little bit technical, but the expert will know what I'm talking about. But this is something that has nothing to do, in principle, on how we define the quantum Hamiltonian evolution. So for this, the first thing one has to do, one has to follow several steps. The first thing is that you have to choose a phase space variable as your time. Usually, a good time is going to be a phase space variable that is not going to commute with the Hamiltonian constraint of the theory. Otherwise, you are going to choose a time that is a Dirac conservable, and you don't want to do that. In our case, for instance, we choose the local space-like volume, so we have a collection of times in our states. So once you choose the time, you have to define a family of unitary transformations, and by unitary I mean norm preserving, so you don't lose information when you apply this transformation, from your states in your physical Hilbert space to some auxiliary Hilbert space that is labeled by the corresponding time function that you are choosing. And finally, the final ingredient that you need is relevant operators or observables that has a well-defined or suitable domain on this auxiliary kinematical Hilbert spaces, HT. So you can define evolution just by combining these transformations in this way. Given a state that is defined in this auxiliary Hilbert space, you can map it into another Hilbert space in a different time, but just applying this combination of this transformation that define the map between the physical Hilbert space and this auxiliary Hilbert space. So we propose this in this paper, and the idea, I will give some more concrete details, is that you start with your solutions, you write them in the corresponding representation of the time that you are choosing, you have a suitable physical inner product, and then looking at the properties of these solutions, you can see if the time is a monotonic function or it is not. If it is a monotonic function, it's fine, you can just continue and define the maps as I will mention now. But if it is not monotonic, as it is the case when we choose the volume as a time coordinate, then the natural thing to do is to split the evolution in the two charts with the volume is monotonic. In order to do so, we apply some projection using some Fourier transforms and the Heaviside theta function, because essentially this corresponds to a sinusoidal function of the v variable. So when you Fourier transform, you will get two deltas in the two sides of the axis of the v variable, and then you just kill one of the deltas and then come back. And then you get essentially a solution, or let's say an Eigen function, that will have the nice unitary evolution that you are looking for. The corresponding maps are defined by using those states projected in the corresponding section where the volume is monotonic, and then out of these maps we can build the corresponding unitary evolution operator. So this is one for each of the monotonic sections or the regions where the volume is monotonic. Then you can build the corresponding states in the Schrödinger picture. You can see that the states are normalized for every choice of volume variables or time that you choose. And eventually you can also define in the standard way the corresponding Dirac observables of the theory, when these O's are operators that are well defined on this state, on the initial time section. So the nice thing about this proposal, first thing is this proposal has been studied in the context of Bianchi 1 spacetime. We are proposing something here that is formal in the sense that we haven't done any numerical calculation to see that it works properly. But what we learn from the Bianchi 1 spacetimes is that this is a very nice Hamiltonian notion of Hamiltonian evolution that works very well in the asymptotic region, or those regions where the time function is monotonic. And we don't need to introduce any classical information, so we can do it everything in the quantum theory. The limitations is that, for instance, when I split the time evolution in the two branches where the time is time function is monotonic, the corresponding states are not solutions of the original Hamiltonian constraint, but these states, this is not a big deal, these states are still related via bijection with the original solution. So in principle, this is not a big problem. However, if you define observables that have an ambiguous meaning in the regions where the time evolution is well defined, whenever you go close to the point where the evolution breaks down, then you lose interpretation of the meaning of those corresponding observables. And finally, we don't know yet how to extend this prescription when you choose a time function that has several bounces and recollapses. For instance, if you go to Freeman-Robertson-Walker spacetime with positive curvature, you have a kind of cyclic universe, and therefore you will have several bounces and recollapses. If you use the volume as a time, then one has to understand a little bit better how to do the extension to this model. And I think in order to apply this to black hole spacetimes, we will need to understand a little bit better this point. So, since I still have some time, I will also mention some properties or something that I am doing that is related with how to extract predictions from these effective geometries. And then I will come back to the case of spherically symmetric spacetimes. Okay? This is something that is general at the moment. But I will particularize this description to a spherically symmetric spacetime to show what a kind of new quantum correction we should expect from these effective geometries. So the idea is that when you introduce, you want to compute, for instance, what happens with quantum field theories on these quantum geometries, you can do these things in two ways. Either you compute the effective geometry from the very beginning, and then you define the quantum field theory on these effective geometries, or you can follow an alternative procedure is that you start with the classical Hamiltonian of this quantum field theory that is coupled to the classical geometry, and then you promote everything to quantum operators, the scalar and the field theory and the geometry. Then you can compute, in the case where you neglect the back reaction, you can in principle compute expectation values of the operators corresponding to the background geometry, and then you are going to get an effective action. Out of this effective action, in principle, you should be able to read what are the corresponding components of the effective metric that this field will see. And obviously, the effective geometry that you are going to get out of here is going to be different from the original effective geometry that you can compute using just the line element. And it is obvious because, as we know in quantum mechanics, the expectation value of products of operators is not the same that the product of expectation values of the corresponding operators. Only in the limit that you can neglect the corresponding fluctuations, they will agree. And then you can study very interesting physical properties, like, for instance, what is the role of the discrete geometry and quantum anisotropies in the CMB, or modifications in Hawking radiation, quasi-normal modes, and these quantum geometries, etc. There is also another proposal that was studied by Gambini and Pulling in how to deal also with quantum field theories on these geometries, but I will not discuss much about this. If you want, you can ask them later. So here I will just give an example and then conclude. For instance, in a spherically symmetric geometry, you introduce just a test massive scalar field. You can compute the corresponding effective action of this field. Then you will have, when you expand the modes in spherical harmonics, the field in modes in terms of these spherical harmonics, the corresponding action will have some expectation values here, multiplying the different terms in the action. And out of these expectation values that are given here, you can just read the corresponding components of the space-time metric. But once you can solve the corresponding components in a unique way using these expectation values. But interestingly, you can see, for example, that if you start with a massive scalar field that has a mass that is constant, quantum fluctuations will give you an effective, or what is called usually dress mass or dress metric, that are essentially these new effective geometries, that knows about the space-time geometry. This quantity, for instance, at the moment that you can neglect quantum fluctuations, this is going to 1, so you will get essentially the same constant mass for the scalar field. But if quantum fluctuations are there, the mass of the scalar field is going to see something. And again, also modifications in the other components of the metric will appear. So I just want to conclude that loop quantum gravity techniques, when you apply them to symmetry reduced model, is able to give successful answers to several questions like singularity resolution, semi-classical geometries, effective descriptions, and also we have been able to deal with the quantization of inhomogeneous spacetimes recently. However, we need to understand a little bit better the quantum dynamics of these geometries, semi-classical sectors, and how to derive effective descriptions that everybody can, in principle, understand. And finally, just to mention that you can introduce these test quantum fields and introduce or get additional phenomenology from out of them, or out of the quantum fluctuations of the geometry within this dress effective metric description, where we can understand the modifications that should we expect with respect to the traditional quantum field theories in curved spacetime that we are used to. Okay, thank you so much. I will conclude here. So, for instance, what I can tell you is we don't have a very deep understanding of this question, but we have analyzed several examples of quantum field theories in this curve spacetime. For instance, in cosmology, you can observe deviation from the standard predictions in inflation. When you consider the standard scenario and you compute the corresponding power spectrum, you, in general, in the classical theory, you had to some problem with when do you give initial conditions. Here, for instance, in the case of loop quantum cosmology, we can start the evolution at the time of the bounds. There are other proposals where you have an emergent universe where you can have a better understanding of these initial conditions for the perturbations. And essentially, most of the proposals used to break the scale invariance of the power spectrum. But they do it usually at very large scale. So in principle, we should expect that it should be something that we should not be observing today, or we are starting to observe today, so that the present observations are not modified. And also, there is another question. In black holes, for instance, there is a proposal that has been studied in more detail by Gambini and Pulin about the Hawking radiation, where the thermal spectrum at some point could stop, and you will see that the black hole is not going to emit any Hawking radiation anymore at some instant of time. So these kind of deviations are the one that one should expect. So I think, yeah, there are very interesting properties that we should expect from these quantum geometries. And what is the role of the discrete geometry in this context, for instance, is something that I think it hasn't been analyzed in detail.
What was nice that you emphasized that the symmetry reduction was applied. So is it true that, could you prove that what is deduced is using the symmetry reduction techniques will remain true if you have a full quantization in loop quantum probability of the four dimensional?
Yes, I
generic.
Yeah, well.
And these statements will remain standing?
I think at least some of them they will remain, but I don't know which ones.
It's a hope or it's proven?
It's
proven or it's a hope?
It's a hope. I mean, we don't have a full quantization in the full theory, right?
There should be some.
The argument, for instance, the argument I can give is, for instance, when you quantize the hydrogen atom, you don't use quantum electrodynamics, right? You can use just a standard quantum mechanics, and then you get the discrete spectrum of the emission of the atom. These properties also remain in the full description, right? So maybe I hope that something similar will happen in the context of loop quantum cosmology versus loop quantum gravity. But I don't have any proof of this. Nobody has, as far as I know. Thank you.